we've sang a couple of times in the past. If it doesn't sound that familiar, please just sing along and let's give praise to God. So please stand with us.
God by coming and to worshiping Him by faith. And so we call each other to worship here, and we call one another to serve Christ diligently. So if you do not know who I am, my name is David Corrente. I am the senior pastor here, and if this is your first time here, you've kind of stumbled upon a wedding ceremony, so to speak. We have a wonderful day planned today where one of my mentors, Pastor Todd Murray from Grace Manuel Bible Church and Expositor Seminary is here, who for the last 4 years has been a part of my life, my wife Chelsea's life, and our boys' lives. And so all this is just a ceremony to wed this marriage, myself and Church of 99, to put his hand of blessing upon it. And what he's going to do today is he's going to charge myself and charge you as a congregation with the Word of God and to kind of send us off right, so to speak. So we're really excited about today. Right after, we're going to have a potluck meal. If you did not bring anything or if you're new here, we just want to serve you. So please stay, please enjoy the company, the fellowship, and just enjoy everything that the members here brought for you. So we just want to serve you today in any capacity we can. Just some body life issues coming up, the fellowship here. Friday, ladies, I'm sorry it's not in the bulletin, but there is our Bible study for the women's ministry Friday night here at 7 p.m. We have some classes coming up, membership classes. We've been speaking about them for a while now, so we have this on the calendar. If you desire to be a member of Church of 99, on October the 18th is going to be our first membership class, October the 18th. And these classes are going to be before the main service, so at 9 a.m. So we're going to give you guys lots of time to get up early and get here for 9 o'clock, and then that will be for 45 minutes. And then our regular service at 10. For anybody who's involved in the children's ministry or desires to be involved in the children's ministry, September 25th, on Friday night at 7 p.m., we're going to have, kind of going to go over a philosophy of ministry. We're going to work over through our new curriculum. So that's going to be for the children's ministry, September 25th. And then September 22nd, which is a Tuesday night at 7 p.m., the worship, the music ministry, we're going to get together and do the very same thing, go over a philosophy of ministry, work through songs, and just talk about why we do what we do here at Church of 99. So don't worry, I know we threw a lot at you. I'll send out an email for all of these, and if you have any questions or cannot make it, please let me know. And so what we want to do today is ask the Lord's favor and blessing. We can see by the weather that he's already blessed this weekend. The Murrays have come from Florida, so today and the last couple days have been good for them. Not too much of a change of climate from the past couple weeks. So let's ask him to bless this time, and then we'll continue to sing to our great God. Bow with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, we're so overwhelmed by the privilege of ministry. Lord, not to ourselves be the glory, but to you be the glory, Father, for what you have done in the hearts of man. That you have come through your Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have redeemed man through the cross. Through Jesus' willingness to come to live as a man, to live the perfect life, to be the sacrifice necessary for sin. And so that those who come to you by faith will receive the reward of eternal life. So, Father, that's why we've come today, to worship the Savior, to worship your Son, to give you all of the glory, and to see that glory perpetuated within the life of the local church. So we thank you for Church of 99. We thank you for what it represents to the body here. Thank you for what it represents to Squamish. And we pray that you will use this lampstand for your glory. And that through your willing minister today, that you will speak through your word. And that the hearts of your people will love your word all the more, will love Christ all the more. So thank you for the opportunity to worship you in a free country, in a place that may not have that opportunity very much longer. May we use this opportunity to worship you freely, and that we come with open hands and open hearts to receive what your word has for us today. So thank you again for Christ, and it's in his name we ask it all. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand while the music team continues to lead us in worship.
This next song is a brand new song for most of us. It's called Before the Throne of God Above, and we're going to ask Kurt to just play through it once, and then we'll sing together.
Sovereign
please remain standing for the public reading of God's Word. I'm going to be reading from the second chapter of 2 Timothy. And what you're witnessing today is the model that this sets. The older men teaching the younger men to be faithful. And so, as I will explain, Todd is kind of the Paul here. I'm the Timothy, and this is the charge to me from Todd. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. The things at which you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Suffer hardship with me as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier in active service entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life, so that he may please the one who enlisted him as a soldier. Also, if anyone competes as an athlete, he does not win the prize unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer ought to be the first to receive his share of the crops. Consider what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, descendant of David, according to my gospel, for which I have suffered hardship even to imprisonment as a criminal. But the word of God is not imprisoned. For this reason I endure all things for the sake of those who are chosen, so that they also may obtain the salvation which is in Christ Jesus, and with it eternal glory. It is a trustworthy statement. For if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind them of these things and solemnly charge them in the presence of God not to wrangle about words, which is useless and leads to the ruin of hearers. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God as a workman who does not need to be ashamed, accurately handling the word of truth. But avoid worldly and empty chatter, for it will lead to further ungodliness. And their talk will spread like gangrene. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, men who have gone astray from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already taken place, and they upset the faith of some. Nevertheless, the firm foundation of God stands, having the seal. The Lord knows those who are his, and everyone who names the name of the Lord is to abstain from wickedness. Now in a large house, there are not only gold and silver vessels, but also vessels of wood and earthenware, and some to honor and some to dishonor. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from these things, he will be a vessel for honor, sanctified, useful to the master, prepared for every good work. Now flee from youthful lusts and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart, but refuse foolish and ignorant speculations, knowing that they produce quarrels. The Lord's bondservant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to all, able to teach, patient when wrong, with gentleness correcting those who are in opposition, if perhaps God may grant the repentance leading to the knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil, having been held captive by him to do his will. You may be seated. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to have Todd perform a song called His Robes for Mine, a favorite song of ours. And so I'm going to pray, and then he'll come lead us, and then the men will grab the offering. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, you call us to be strong. But in opposition to the world, it is a strength that is not our own. It is a strength within Christ. It is a strength within which he has done for us. And any measure of faithfulness that we have proves your faithfulness. Any measure of faithlessness that we have proves our weaknesses. But Father, you have given us your Spirit. You have given us your Word. You have given us men who have stayed steadfast through the trials of life. Whether it's been hardships, suffering, persecution, imprisonment, Lord, you have shown yourself to be faithful. And so we pray here that we are marked by faithfulness to your word. We pray that as a people that we look on to our own souls to know what the word must do and impact our own lives and then pass that on to the next generation. So we thank you for what this day represents in that very thing. And so we are struggling, we are praising, we are worshiping, we are joyful, whatever state that we have come to your house today to worship you, I pray that this day ministers to each and every soul. And Father, you've given us our hands and our feet and our minds to work for you and to work for our families and to work for the resources that we have. And so we pray that we've come with cheerful hearts to give cheerfully, to know that the work of our hands are ultimately to produce gospel fervor within our hearts and within the church. And so that the gospel may go forth here in Squamish and to the other ends of the earth. So may we come with a consecrated heart, a pure heart, to desire to serve and to worship you. And may your church be magnified, may your Son be magnified to the glory of your name. In Jesus Christ, holy name of Jesus. Amen.
I cling to Christ.
Pastor Todd, let us stand and let's answer that message of love, that enduring love which lasts forever, because our Lord is a mighty fortress. Let's give him praise.
Over the past 4 years, as I've been training for seminary, the Expositor Seminary in Jupiter, Florida, at Grace Emmanuel Bible Church. Their impact in our lives is hard to put into words, and it still continues to this day. And so it's a pleasure for me to introduce Pastor Todd Murray to you and our flock for him opening up the Word of God. And last night he was able to put on a presentation about John Newton, and the life that he described John Newton was a well-balanced and a faithful life of a man of God. And that is the very thing that we see in Todd and his wife, Tanny, faithfully striving after Christ and their love for the Word of God. And so please, with a warm hand, please welcome my mentor, my friend, and father in the faith, Pastor Todd Murray.
Good morning. Thank you for your hospitality. I hear that the weather is like this 365 days a year, so my kids are ready to move. As strange as it may sound, after living as a flatlander for most of my life, waking up in the morning and driving and looking out and seeing, I had this funny reaction the second day. Look, the mountains are still here. It's like you're expecting them to go somewhere. On my visual field, in my visual field, just getting used to anything on the horizon besides a cloud is just amazing. So what a beautiful place for the Lord to be planting His church and growing a beautiful people. And so as David mentioned, today is in many ways like a wedding ceremony. It's that blend of joy and celebration, but it's also blended with sobriety. A bride and a groom, as they come into the room, are filled with joy, but when the pastor opens the Word of God and begins to teach them in that ceremony, or when vows are exchanged, that joy is mixed with a kind of sobriety that's kind of unlike almost anything else. And so today we want to blend together those two flavors, a sense of joy, a sense of sobriety, because in essence, as a training ministry in Florida, we've sent you one of our finest sons. And so this is sort of when we confess, we've been playing matchmaking. And you've sort of vetted him, and we've sort of vetted you. And so I guess I'm here as the official marriage broker to say, I think this is a marriage made in heaven. Literally, made in heaven by God Himself. So, as I thought about what passage of Scripture I could blend together, because sometimes at an installation service like this, there'll be two men who come. One who will bring a message to charge the new preacher, the pastor, the shepherd. Another man sometimes will come and charge the congregation. And since I was coming alone, I wanted a passage of Scripture that would blend together a charge to you as a people and a charge to you as their shepherd. And so if you'll turn in your Bibles, I landed in the book of Titus, chapter 2. And we'll be looking together at these first 8 verses of Titus chapter 2. Let me read the passage and let me give you a little bit of context for not just us today, but for the book of Titus in general. Hear the word of the Lord, beginning in chapter 2, verse 1. But as for you, speak the things which are fitting for sound doctrine. Older men are to be temperate, dignified, sensible, sound in faith, in love, in perseverance. Older women likewise are to be reverent in their behavior, not malicious gossips or enslaved to much wine, teaching what is good, so that they may encourage the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, to be sensible, pure, workers at home, kind, being subject to their own husbands, so that the word of God will not be dishonored. Likewise, the young men are to be sensible. In all things, show yourself, speaking to Titus, to be an example of good deeds with purity in doctrine, dignified, sound in speech, which is beyond reproach, so that the opponent will be put to shame, having nothing bad to say about us. If you look at that paragraph of Scripture, what you have is it begins with an instruction to Titus. Then it begins to talk about the implications of gospel truth in the lives of virtually everyone in the church. Older men, older women, younger men.
So none of us get off unscathed by this passage, unaddressed, uninformed, unencouraged by the Word of God. Then the passage ends again the same way it began, by addressing Titus himself. So what you'll see is, I'll address your shepherd, Dave. I'll address you as a people from the Word of God. And then I'll address Dave again from this passage. Titus was a young pastor, not unlike your new pastor, in the sense that he is freshly trained, freshly mentored, and now freshly sent to the Isle of Crete. He'd been asked in chapter 1 to sort of finish the work that Paul had begun and to establish elders there in that place. And it was not maybe the most pleasant place to be a pastor. The people on the island of Crete, one of their own poets said about themselves, "Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, and lazy gluttons." So, welcome to your new congregation. So, that's how they thought of themselves. So, imagine in the light of God Almighty and His holy standards, how did God view this sensual culture that this young man had been sent to pastor and establish a church and establish leadership there? In chapter 1, Paul gives Titus the instructions for what should be the character qualifications of any man who is going to shepherd this flock on the island of Crete. Then he goes on to describe the wickedness of false teachers. And now, as we get to chapter 2, it's not so much the leaders themselves, but what's to be the nature and the content of what the leader is to teach. So in chapter 1, the man himself who will lead a congregation, who is he to be? And in chapter 2, what is to be the nature of his ministry? And so what we'll look together is that in this passage, Paul is describing not just gospel truth and doctrine, but the implications in the life and character of where the gospel hits home. What are the implications of the teaching of gospel truth for Pastor Titus himself and for four groups within the church? So let's look first at the command to teach doctrine and all of its life implications. He begins by saying, "But as for you," Titus. Chapter 2, verse 1. "But as for you." And the "but" is there, meaning as a contrast to what he just talked about in chapter 1, which were false teachers. In contrast to the false teachers who teach contaminated words. In contrast to the false teachers whose character and life are out of control and evil, you be distinct and different from them. In other words, the strategy, says Paul, for pushing back on Cretan culture and all its wickedness, the strategy is preach truth. But Paul uses some unique language here. He doesn't simply say, speak sound doctrine. He says, speak the things fitting for sound doctrine. And we'll look at that together in a moment. But this word for sound doctrine is used all over the New Testament, and particularly in 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus. Clearly, part of what you are charged to do is to bring sound doctrine to these people. So, listen to an overview of some of the other passages that talk about the importance of sound doctrine. By the way, that word sound, it's used, for instance, of the prodigal son, that it says, "My son has come back safe and sound," meaning healthy and robust, without injury, without disease. This is the word that we get our English word hygiene from. So the idea is undiseased, robust, healthy doctrine. And so what you have is this inextricable link in the New Testament that says healthy, sound doctrine always leads to healthy, holy, robust living. And contaminated, shady, diseased doctrine always leads to shady, edgy, contaminated living. So listen, as the scriptures charge your shepherd to shepherd you with nothing less than sound doctrine. Chapter 1, verse 9 of this epistle, an elder must be able to teach and refute false teachers. In 1 Timothy, an elder must be able to teach. In 1 Timothy 4, you, Dave, were to be not only teaching them sound doctrine, but personally nourished on it yourself. So the words that you preach become the spiritual diet of your own soul. You're told in 1 Timothy to prescribe and to teach, to give attention to exhortation and teaching, to take pains with these things and be absorbed in them. You're told to entrust to faithful men, as you read earlier this morning, who will be able to teach others also. You're to remind the church. You're to solemnly charge this church. You're to be diligent to present yourself an unashamed workman. You're to continue in all the things that you've learned and received from a legacy of men both dead and living. And then finally, in 2 Timothy 4, as you know, you're to preach the word. You're to reprove, to rebuke, and to exhort and to do all that with great patience and patient instruction. But that's probably not news to you or to Dave. That of course he's come here to preach the word of God and to teach you doctrine. But notice how Paul actually phrases it to Timothy. He doesn't say, but as for you, speak sound doctrine. Instead what he says is, speak the things which are fitting for sound doctrine. That's not less than doctrine. It's teaching doctrine straight up distilled and put out there alone is not enough in and of itself. Your shepherd will come to this pulpit and be in your homes and be in small groups and be in Bible studies and be on hikes with you and bike rides, which is where I would do all my discipleship if I lived here. He will come to you and say, I'm not only going to teach you doctrine, I'm going to teach you the things that are in accord with or are fitting for sound doctrine. The word means suitable or proper to a given situation. So Dave is to communicate the implications of the truth that he teaches. Later in this book, Paul would say to Titus, tell your people to adorn the doctrine of God with holy living, to decorate your doctrine. Ladies, when you get dressed, you're not done until you've finished accessorizing the final touches on your outfit. In essence, take your doctrine now and with good deeds out in the world, enhance or make more beautiful, accessorize your truth that you learn to love with good deeds. Dave, you know, you push away from your desk, just mastering the doctrine of the text really doesn't make you a shepherd. It makes you a talking head. But when you come to your people and you begin to press the implications, challenge them to adorn this doctrine with godly living, now you're obeying what Paul said to Titus. Speak not just sound doctrine, but the things fitting for sound doctrine. There is no true orthodoxy without orthopraxy, the practice of that doctrine. This is your shepherd's task. This is what you should expect. You get to overhear God giving him a job description. Lucky Dave, he has 100 of you to tell him what to do. But you know, we want to be reminded as shepherds. If you see us distracted or straying from this, then come and remind us of our calling. Don't create expectations for your shepherd that would be different from what the Lord is charging him here to do. So speak the things fitting for sound doctrine. The end goal of instruction, says Paul in 1 Timothy 1, is love from a pure heart, a good conscience, and a sincere faith. If in the end your teaching ministry isn't producing that in the hearts of your people, then maybe it's time to come back and say, am I speaking not only doctrine, but the things fitting for sound doctrine? Well, the next few verses move us beyond just instruction to a shepherd like Titus and move us to the gospel implications. So he said, you are to teach doctrine and all its implications in people's lives. And now what Paul does is say, and here are some of those implications. And this is where four groups in the church get addressed. Older men, older women, younger women, and young men. And so this will be my charge to you. And then we'll come back to another charge to your new shepherd. Maybe the best thing to say at this point, I was calculating in bed last night, if I took together all these descriptions and I spent 60 seconds apiece on them, we still might run late. So I'm going to try to fly like the wind through these qualifications. But these are worthy goals to set in your mind, for this is who the Lord wants me to be. If I'm a young man, this is who I should be when I'm an older man. If I'm a young woman, this is what I'm aiming at as an older woman. If I'm an older woman, this is the influence I could have on the younger women in our church. Older men, you can have this wonderful influence as you look at the description of what it means to be Christ-like. But perhaps I should offer just one other word of explanation before we look at these. And that is, if your pastor is faithful to preach doctrine and all its tentacles of implications in your lives, don't resent it. You might be tempted to push back at someone to say, just stick to the pulpit, would you, buddy? Stay out of my life. Sometimes our proud hearts, our comfortable hearts, are not interested in coming to church and hearing, seeing the Word of God and being convicted and looking into a mirror, as the Word of God describes itself in James, and seeing dirt on your face and being unwilling to wipe it off, to deal with that sin. So you should come expecting a faithful brother, as a if we say this in Canada, but in America we'll say to get in your kitchen, in the inner workings of your life. And so this is what you should expect. In other words, all that follows in verses 3 through 5 are a description of what it means for a faithful shepherd to teach sound doctrine and the things that are fitting or appropriate for it. So let's begin with mature men in verse 2. Older men are to be temperate. Literally, it means holding no wine. It's literally to be sober-minded, to be non-intoxicated. So the word came to mean to be clear-headed, to be self-controlled in regards to one's appetites and desires. But given the Cretans' weakness, and we're told by them, their own poets, that they're evil beasts and lazy gluttons, given the fact this is a very sensual culture, it may have retained some of its original meaning. Older men, don't be given to intoxication of any kind, with any desire. This same word temperate is used as a qualification for all elders in 1 Timothy 3, but now it's being applied not to elders, but to all older men in the church. So older men are to be temperate, to be sober-minded. There are really only two kinds of men in the world. Those who are mastered by themselves and enslaved to sin, and those who by God's power and grace and the freeing power of the gospel have mastered themselves. Older men in the church, show us how it's done to be a man who is characterized by self-control. But not only are older men to be temperate, they're to be dignified. Now, this is not the snobbery of the upper classes. This is not a stuffy gloominess. But rather, what Paul has in mind is, be the kind of person who possesses older men, a kind of gravitas, a kind of seriousness about life, its purposes, and its goals. Be the kind of man who's worthy of the honor and respect that Scripture says should be paid to older men. This is the call men to strive to be respected, not to be liked. And it implies a life of well-regulated habits and moral sincerity inside and out. Older men are also called to be sensible. Your Bible may use the word self-control. This word is often translated self-control. I don't like self-control here because it's sort of the underpinning underneath self-control. Self-control is something observable. And this word is talking about a mindset, an inner attitude that becomes the foundation for making choices that you can see on the outside that we call self-control. So this is actually the invisible heart foundation that undergirds the visible choices that you and I look at a man's life and say, there's a man of self-control. Sensible. It's interesting. Every group in this list will be called to be sensible. Older men, older women, younger women, young men. This is an important word for Paul in this sensual culture, that you have the mindset on the inside that it helps you make self-control, discipline, life choices. Older men are also to be sound in faith, in love, and in perseverance. There's that word sound again. Robust and healthy. So the older men of a congregation are to have a healthy faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Not in the sense that they've arrived, but rather you're like concrete that's been poured, but it hasn't hardened yet. You met some older people and you could just tell they're hardened. That's it. They're stuck. They've quit growing. This is a call for an older man to continue growing in his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Older men are also to have a healthy, robust love. Is it love for Christ in this passage? Is it love for others? Hard to tell, perhaps not important to even try to distinguish the two. Older men, robust in their love for Christ and His church. And then finally, older men are to be healthy or robust or sound in their perseverance. Meaning there's something exemplary about young men being able to watch an older man. This idea of perseverance means you have borne up with a difficult circumstance and over a long period of time. That's just one of the advantages of having some mileage, having some chronological maturity, is to be able to say, I've had the opportunity by God's grace to bear up with difficult circumstances over the long haul. So Dave, as you preach to your people, you preach not only doctrine, but you preach the implications of it. And Paul has listed here some of them. These are the kind of men you want to train. Older men in the congregation, rise up and demonstrate for the women, the children, and the younger men. What does it look like to be this kind of godly older man? Next in verse 3, the second group who has some examples of the implications of the gospel that are a part of teaching, it's mature women. And look what the apostle, how he addresses mature women. Older women, likewise, are to be reverent in their behavior. This is actually the only time that word reverent is used in the New Testament. It's associated in Greek literature outside of the Bible. It's associated with priestess, a priestess who would consecrate herself to a false god. And so now Paul grabs that word and says, in the same way a priestess would shed all her other life interests to dedicate herself to a false god, then ladies, you remain as older women focused on the gospel. In essence, become a woman who doesn't belong to herself, but is focused on giving her life away for God and for others. It's hard not to think of someone like Anna in Luke's gospel. Anna, do you remember? A woman who had been widowed and for many years had been standing in the temple serving and waiting to see the Messiah. So ladies, you are to be, as godly women, exemplary in the church in that you have a focused life, that you, in the words of the Apostle Paul, you have not counted your life as dear to yourself in any way. Not only are you to be reverent then in your behavior and your life, you're also called not to be malicious gossips. This is actually the word that's often translated Satan. You're not to be she-devils. Boy, that's strong language, isn't it? What's the idea here? The idea is you're not to be a slanderer. That's one of the roles of the devil. He stands before the Father, and he accuses and slanders God's people. So this is a warning that apparently in the later chapters of life, older women are uniquely tempted and instructed by Paul here, Titus, teach these women, one of the implications of the gospel, is to control their tongue. You're never more like the devil than when you gossip or slander, is what Paul is saying. And be careful, one can be guilty of gossip, not just by talking, but guilty of theft by receipt. Guilty of listening to words. Older women, lead the way and set the example by not involving yourself in this unproductive, unedifying kind of speech. Next, the apostle says, nor are they to be enslaved to much wine. While it's a different vocabulary word, it's that same call to temperance that the older men received. Remember what the Bible says, that the one who commits sin is a slave to sin? And so, on the island of Crete, apparently it would not be uncommon for older women to be enslaved to wine. In our day and age, we see not only enslavement to alcohol continuing, as it did in New Testament times, but now enslavement to all kinds of abuse of pharmaceutical drugs. And that would apply in the same principle. You're to be the kind of woman who's dedicated herself to the Lord, who doesn't involve herself in unedifying speech, and is not enslaved to too much wine. The implications of the gospel reaching all the way into the private habits of an older woman. And then finally, on a more positive note, older women are told to teach what is good. This means to teach by word and example. So use your experience, ladies, to train up the next generation. What you've learned in your years of living and walking with Christ, you could see that, in essence, this, apparently focusing on self is a real temptation in the later years of life. And this is a call, teach others. Don't be self-absorbed and don't be self-focused. Isn't it interesting that now for both older men and older women, the emphasis of what Paul's saying is on the interior of the mind, on how to think rightly before you even attempt to do rightly. So in what they pursue and what they avoid in the interior of their mind. Now in verses 4 and 5, the apostle says to Titus, teach gospel implications, not just for older men and older women, but also for teach the younger women as well. Though there's sort of an intermediary here, and that is older women are to teach the younger women. You've already been told, older women, to teach what is good, and now that good is specified. Look at verse 4. So that they, the older women, may encourage the young women to love their husbands, to love their children, etc. It doesn't show up well in your English Bible, but that word encourage is actually the verb form of that same word sensible that older men and older women have already been encouraged to have. So, in essence, this isn't a real verb, but think of it this way. Sensibilize the young women. Older women are to teach them. What's the mindset that you should have? To curb their actions, their attitudes, their words. And older women, your informal teaching of the word and your example to show younger women what rational, thoughtful living looks like in the area of what I'll call domestic holiness, which is no small range. But Gordon Fee says this, older women are wise them up. Wise up the younger women. And then it gets very specific as to what it is that older women are to teach the younger women. And it begins with to love your husbands and to love your children. Ladies, this should be an encouragement to you, especially if you're a young mother of young children. Because you have probably experienced, like many women have, that it may strike you odd as counterintuitive. Why would a woman have to be instructed to love her husband and children? I mean, before you were married in particular, you probably thought, if there's anything that will come naturally and easy to me, it will be loving my wonderful husband and my children. But if you've been married a while, you're probably acquainted with some of the challenges. You found out we as husbands are not so lovable after all. And you found out that the children that were so adorable when they're sleeping eventually wake up. And they're not always lovable. So ladies, I think you should take encouragement here as you hear the Word of God say this. Not everything about being a wife and mother will come easy or natural. You will want and need an older Christian woman to help you do something as fundamental as loving us and lovable husband and loving these children who are in desperate need of training. Older women, do you notice that the scripture says you are to teach this? And the implication seems to be that you approach a young woman and say, can I meet you? Could I talk with you? Could I help you? Ladies, I'll say this, if you're a young woman without that older woman in your life and you see a woman in the church that you admire, then you certainly are not forbidden to go and ask her, but older women, how much would it mean to a younger woman if you took the initiative there and came towards her? A busy young mother who admires you in your older age may be reluctant to come. Oh, she's too busy. She has too many things. I could never ask her. Make it easier on the younger ladies. So here's gospel implications. Older women are to teach younger women to love their husbands and to love their children. You can begin to see why an older woman who's an alcoholic and a gossip could never qualify to teach a young woman the kinds of things that the Lord wants her to teach. Here is that word sensible again. Look in verse 5. Not only should an older woman teach the younger women to love their husbands, to love their children, but to be sensible. There's that word again, the inner mindset, the infrastructure of the heart that leads to a self-controlled, disciplined life. So self-control is a good synonym, but it doesn't really get at underneath it. It's sort of the backstory, the foundation. Younger women need to be sensibilized. Ladies, you're also called to be pure. This is a word that's used usually in religious settings for ritual cleansing. It came to mean inner moral purity. At the very least, it meant to be sexually pure, but probably here in the mind of the Apostle Paul, an inner purity of heart. This word pure is the same word that's translated chaste in 1 Peter, that if a woman finds herself married to an unbelieving man, she is to live her chaste and respectful behavior, become the most powerful gospel witness she could offer her husband. The next phrase for younger women is they're to be workers at home. While this text does not forbid working outside the home, it does command that women have a home-heart anchor, that the home is the anchor, the central ministry of their life. Working outside the home certainly presents additional challenges to that, but doesn't make it impossible to obey this command. Nevertheless, here's clearly what's on the apostle's mind. Not do you ever go outside your home and earn income. What's on the apostle's mind is this. Do you have, ladies, as the priority of your heart, to be a lover of your husband and a lover of your children? How you and your husband and your family work out the details is certainly something you could be open to shepherding on, but the point is, ladies, have a heart that's anchored in your primary ministry at home. The next word he uses is the word kind. Not only are to older women to teach younger women to work at home, but now he's sort of modifying how they should do it, to be kind in the doing. Ladies, the temptation for you in domestic responsibilities is massive. I get it. I have 5 kids. I've watched my wife for 33 years. And I am at least sympathetic to the fact that no sooner did you finish all the laundry than in our house, 5 children come home and drop another set of dirty ones at the end of that day. It's like your work is never done. And load the dishwasher before you know it, it's full again. So I think the temptation to be a worker at home is challenging. To be a worker at home who's kind, you've probably all experienced the temptation towards impatience and frustration. Hard to be kind if your heart's anchored at home. That is a challenge. Next, ladies are called to be subject to their husbands. Not only now called to love their husbands, but to follow their leadership, to have an attitude, a demeanor, not just a willingness, okay, I'll do what you say, you're the boss, but rather it's this inclination, a demeanor that says, I love your leadership, I love supporting it, I love when you plan and provide and protect our family, and I'm happy to follow you as I would follow Jesus Christ. So, ladies, it's more an attitude of supportiveness of your husband's leadership. And then finally, the Apostle Paul says, let me tell you what's at stake here. When older women teach younger women, it protects the purity of the gospel itself. Do you see that last phrase? So that the word of God will not be dishonored. Why should you be pursuing loving your husband and submitting to his leadership, loving your children, being a worker at home, being kind, being pure, being sensible? Why should you pursue these things? Because the gospel's at stake. If this is not the kind of young woman you are, then on the island of Crete, the word of God will be dishonored by you. There's no small weight that's being placed. So if you're ever tempted to think, all I do is stay at home, I'm raising up kids, I'm not making any contribution. Chelsea, in these years, you're trying to plant a ministry. And at the same time, you're gloriously, by God's grace, expecting your fourth term. There are going to be days where you just feel like, I can't be with Dave every day. I can't do everything in church that I used to do and would like to do. And just various seasons in her life, her involvement will, by necessity, come and go. And you're going to have to anchor your soul in this truth, that this doesn't frustrate God. And that you being at home and anchored there does more to bring honor to the Word of God than, you know, all the other activities that could come with the role of being Dave's wife. Just be careful, look for that balance, look to him for leadership. Am I doing too much? Am I not doing enough? And you are, you know, you're getting two for one, right? I mean, if the Bible didn't forbid women being pastors, Chelsea would make great. You know what I'm saying? I mean, this is a gift in a wife. She is an enhancement to this brother's ministry. You didn't smile when I said that. I'm not for women preaching. That was totally a joke. All I'm saying is this is the kind of woman who will not distract or discredit her husband in ministry. The Lord has given you not a choice man. The Lord has given you a choice couple. And Dave is blessed, and you are blessed to have her in the midst. Older women, come alongside her. Help her. Encourage her. Give her the advice. Be honest and explain. It's not always easy. Because sometimes the younger women think, am I crazy? This is so hard. And now finally, younger men. Younger men in Bible times, anything up to the age of 40 was considered young. In some extra-biblical documents, even 50 was considered young. But as a 53-year-old man, I've given up any hope of any New Testament definition of being a younger man. I am officially an older man. Younger men, you might be tempted to say, man, what a ripoff. Look at verse 6. We get only one command. Likewise, urge the younger men to be sensible. There's that word again. The invisible mental undergirding of a renewed mind that knows how to think and that is spiritually informed when it comes to making life choices that we call externally self-control. Young men, I don't know if this means that young men can only handle one thing. Everybody else gets a list, a catalog, and young men get one thing to work on. I don't think it's a reflection of denseness on the young man's part. What I think is that this is like the Atwell Peak. For a young man, this is the ultimate. This is the challenge, man, to have a mind that leads to self-controlled living. You read earlier from 1 Timothy chapter 2. Give me a second. 2 Timothy 2 and the importance of self-control there. Young men, this is in some ways helpful to say, I've really only got one thing to work on. And if I can get that scripturally informed, renewed mind, then it's almost as though everything else has a ripple effect, like that's the hub, and the spokes of the wheel will be aligned. This is the ultimate challenge for young men, to develop a mind and a heart that makes them make self-controlled choices, not only in public, but also in private. Urge the young men, Dave, you are to continually, habitually exhort and encourage over and over again with your words and your deeds. Urge the young men of this congregation to be sensibilized, to be sound in their thinking. Urge the young men to take personal moral responsibility, to keep their spiritual wits about them. Urge them to control themselves, to be sane in an insane world, to be thoughtful in a shallow world, to be disciplined in an indulgent world, to have proper attitudes and priorities, and to make that mind the habit of their life. You're going to have to do it over and over and over again. Young men, you may only get one word, only one characteristic to pursue. But oh, what a lifetime of training and growth and failing and repenting is contained in that one word. Finally, congregation, you've endured your charge. We're back to Pastor Dave. Look at verses 7 and 8, where in essence, the apostle is now giving a charge to every elder. Titus has been left in Crete for the very purpose of establishing eldership. And so whatever it is that the apostle has to say to Titus, he would say to Dave. And so here it is, verses 7 and 8. In all things, Dave, show yourself to be an example of good deeds. Good deeds is an important word in the book of Titus. He says that Jesus came to purify for himself a people who are zealous for good deeds. So all God's people, zealous and enthusiastic about doing good deeds. But for you, good deeds are also a pursuit. And the range that you're asked to pursue in all things. In your private life, in your public life, in your family life, in the pulpit, in this community. In every way, you are to be involved in being exemplary in good deeds. To be an example in your preaching is not enough. It's not enough just to preach it. You've got to live it. Listen to how the Apostle Paul could speak. Dave, can you say this about your life? I exhort you, be imitators of me, just as I am of Christ. That's God's charge to you, to be able to say to any member of this flock, imitate me as I imitate Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 1, the Apostle Paul writes, you became imitators of us and the Lord, all the leaders. 2 Thessalonians, you yourselves know how you ought to follow our example, because we did not act in an undisciplined manner among you, but in order to offer ourselves as a model for you so that you could follow our example. Did you hear the word? You ought to follow our example. Now, Paul is either a man of pristine character, or he is just a tremendous egomaniac. And we know he's a humble man. And yet a humble man can still say, a godly leader can say, you ought to follow me as I follow Christ. Paul says of Timothy in 2 Timothy, you, Timothy, you followed my teaching, my conduct, my faith, my patience, my love, my perseverance, my persecutions, and my sufferings. I'm going to follow you and imitate you in all areas and in all good deeds. 2 Timothy, the scripture says, if any man cleanses himself from sin, then he will be a vessel of honor, sanctified, useful, and prepared for what? For every good work. God-breathed scripture from 2 Timothy 3 says that God-breathed scripture is given to you so that as a man of God you may be adequate and equipped for every good work. Contrast that with false teachers who are worthless for good deeds, the scripture says. But not only are you to be an example in every area of your life, you are also to keep your doctrine pure. Look at what the Word of God says next in verse 7. In all things, show yourself to be an example of good deeds with purity in doctrine. Dave, I believe this is a call for the content of your doctrine to be pure and for the motive of your teaching ministry to be pure. It's both the content and the process. They both matter to God. In regards to purity of content, no departure from the truth. 2 Timothy 1, retain the standard of sound words that you've heard from me in the faith and love which are in Christ Jesus. Guard the treasure that's been entrusted to you. Implicit in that word, retain them, hold on to them, and guard them and protect them. That means there are forces of evil that would wrest truth from your hands and from your grip. Plan to hold tightly your grip, to be pure in the content of your doctrine. For you to preach is to be the herald of another's message. Don't be tempted. No one came to hear anything you have to say. Come and just tell them what the Word of God says. One of the enemies of sticking to pure doctrine will be fear of man, caring too much what people think. If I preach that, who will I offend? If I preach this, who will think ill of me? Who will think I'm harsh? Who will think I'm weak? Who will think I'm too tender? Who will think I'm too tough? Just preach the word of God. John MacArthur, as you know, is fond of saying, you're not the chef. You don't make the food. You're just the waiter. Try to get the food to the table without spilling the soup. That's our job. What does the word of God say? But not only should you be pure in your content, you also need to be pure in your motive as you teach. The Apostle Peter would write, shepherd the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not under compulsion, but voluntarily, willingly, with a desire to do it, according to the will of God, not for sordid gain, but with eagerness. Not lording it over those allotted to your charge, but proving to be an example to the flock. Your doctrine must be pure in its content, and your heart must be pure in its motives. Paul would write in 1 Thessalonians 2, our exhortation did not come from error or impurity, there's purity of content, or by way of deceit, that's purity of methodology. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak not as pleasing men, but God who examines our hearts. God sees your heart when you preach it. You won't get away in the mind of God with saying the right thing while your heart is going somewhere else. So the Word of God sees and judges. God examines our hearts. We never came with flattering speech, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed. God is witness. Nor did we seek glory from men, either from you or from others. Stay pure in your doctrine, in its content, and in your heart motive. Just a few more qualifiers. Look what the Word of God says next. Not only to be pure in doctrine, but also to be dignified. All this means is that when you stand behind this sacred desk, there is to be a gravitas, a respectability about you. There's no place for silliness in the pulpit, which is not the same as saying there's no place for humor, ever. But a silly lightheartedness in the pulpit, when God's people are waiting to be fed, is always inappropriate for a shepherd. Of course, it goes without saying that nowadays we see pulpits defiled by profane language, by sexual innuendo in the pulpit. You are to be dignified when you teach people the Word of God. Again, not stuffy or pretentious or unreal, but always dignified by the holiness of the content of what you're teaching. Next, the Apostle says that Titus is to be sound in speech. There's that word sound again. Your ministry is one of words. Give the life-giving Word of God. Robust, healthy words will come out of your mouth. In this pulpit, in this aisle, in the fellowship hall, at a meal, in people's homes. You are to be sound in your speech, which is beyond reproach. The idea beyond reproach, as you know, brother, is not that no one could accuse you, but that no one could accuse you legitimately. Just as an elder is called to live above reproach, church, what that means is not that an elder could never be accused of anything. No one can stop tongues from wagging. People will talk. But that no accusation could actually stick against an elder. And here, you're characterized by the kind of speech, oh, people might complain about it, but no real accusation, no legitimate word could be spoken against you. Let all charges against your speech be fraudulent. And then finally, he ends with a motivator. Why? Why must Titus, why must you, Dave, be this kind of shepherd? So that, here's the purpose, the opponent, who's the opponent? The false teachers from the end of chapter 1. Those who oppose the gospel. So that the opponent will have nothing bad to say about, and I expected the text to say, about you. But instead, the text says, about us. Dave, you will have opponents to your preaching. You can never just be a man who's no. The luxury of being a man, I just want to be a man who's known by what I'm for, not what I stand against. That's a desire that has to be killed if you're going to be a faithful shepherd. You will have to be known by what you are for, but you will also have to be known by what you're against. There are enemies of the gospel, and they will rise up against you. And they will be opponents, opposing to your teaching. Jesus would say, beware if everyone is squamish, for it is going to be a speech will of you. probably means you're not being faithful to the text. Beware if all men speak well of you. But finally, as one who's had a small part in your training, I want to just point your attention to the last word of the opponent who had nothing bad to say about us. Brother, you are a reflection of an entire church who loved you for 4 years, who trained you and who sent you, and today, it's like you've been engaged, but today's the marriage. Today we're saying I do. Today we're making it official. We're officially saying you're the right man for this job. We're officially saying to you as another church, he really is who he appears to be. As much as any man can know another man's heart, I commend this dear brother and his family to you. But brother, never let it be off your mind that you're a reflection on me, Jerry, Doc, Bob, Matt, John, and 600 other people who call themselves Grace Emmanuel Bible Church. If you betray the Lord, if you compromise, you betray me, and you betray every man who loved you and taught you to be a shepherd. Listen to what the Apostle Paul said to Timothy at the end of chapter 6 in 1 Timothy. Dave, I charge you, as Paul did Timothy, I charge you in the presence of God who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus who testified the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep the commandment without stain or reproach. For how long? Until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. Dave, I get emails, phone calls, read blog posts every day from people who are my peers who have betrayed the true gospel, who have gone astray, and have not kept the commandment unstained. They stain it with moral infidelity. They stain it with theological lack of integrity. The temptations on the right and the left for you and the rest of your life are massive. I charge you, in the presence of Christ, who didn't blow it in his speech under the pressure of Pontius Pilate, keep the commandment of God unstained until that pure Jesus comes back again. Until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the proper time, he who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone possesses immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen nor can see. To this one be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you that in your brilliant wisdom you arranged for this flock to be joined with this shepherd. I thank you for helping them during the last couple of years, especially where they have been without a shepherd. Thank you for holding them together, for not allowing them to utterly come apart at the seams. Thank you that today represents the answer to many private and corporate prayers. Lord, bring us a pastor. Bring us a shepherd. And meanwhile, I'm just about as far away as you could go and still be in North America. You were busy training a man who's been praying for 2 years. Lord, give me a flock, give me a people, and give me a place. So thank you for those who trained and invested in this man. Thank you for Grace Advance and becoming a part of the process whereby this congregation and Dave came to know one another. Thank you for Lance Quinn and his role in this, for Carl Hargrove at Grace Advance. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for answering prayers. And I do pray that you would absolutely grip my brother's heart with the necessity to teach sound doctrine and nothing less than sound doctrine, but to teach it in all its implications. And I pray that you keep this flock's heart soft and open and pliable and teachable, ready to receive the doctrine and all its implications, which at times will step on our toes and be so convicting. Lord, you know our lazy hearts would love for every sermon to be consoling and not convicting. But Lord, that's not what our hearts need. We need to be challenged so that we can be, for the sake of the gospel, these kind of older men and women, these kind of younger men and women, and this kind of shepherd and pastor. So for the glory of Jesus Christ as his kingdom spreads in Squamish, Father, I pray that you would bless the uniting of this family and this congregation. We pray in Jesus' name. One final charge I'd like to offer Dave. I'm going to slip over to the piano. If you may want to open your Bibles to 2 Timothy chapter 4. I'm just going to sing from 2 Timothy 4, those first four verses, and preach the word in season and out of season.
Presence.
we've come to the end, but we want to ask all of you men, if you're affirming of this man being the new shepherd of the Church of 99, as we at Grace Emmanuel Bible Church are commending him to you, then I'm going to ask all the men in the church who affirm this to come up and lay your hands on Dave, and let's pray for him together as we sort of officially inaugurate his ministry now. And then a couple of men are going to lead us in prayer. But every man who's supportive of Dave, ready to be submissive to his leadership. Let's pray for him.
Gratitude just towards what you've done for this church on 99, your church, Lord Jesus Christ. May the power and the glory be in your hands forever and ever, Lord. And thank you for using David as a vessel for the preaching of the word and the truth of your gospel.
Lord Jesus, we come today in your presence. As simple people, not worthy to come in the presence of the Almighty God, who came to rescue these faithful people. Father, you blessed us with a promise in December of 2013, in the words of Joel 3:18, that once again, a fountain will stream out of your house to water the valley of Shittim, and we have held onto that promise, Lord, that you would once again save us individually and save a church life for your glory and for the glory of this town. You know how much we have held to that promise, Lord. I want to honor every congregation member here that poured hours of prayer into praying for that is not visible. Just trusting in you, Lord. Thank you for gracing us with a faith that saves. We've seen it manifest in front of our eyes here, Lord. Let this be a testimony of your faithfulness. In Jeremiah 3:15, you said that you would give a shepherd to your flock, a shepherd according to your heart, to teach us. And today we can say, Lord, once again you've kept your promise. My prayer for David is that in the words of Acts 20:28, that he would watch himself, that he would watch over this flock, and that he would honor the fact that it's your people, your souls, that you bought with your precious blood on the cross. We've seen in him the qualities of a shepherd that you require, which is love, patience, gentleness. We ask for you to continue to bless him with these attributes. That is not from in itself himself, because like most of us, or all of us, he is a fallen man. And we ask that you protect him and his family, each one of the boys, and the unborn baby, Chelsea, that you would individually be a prominent part of their lives. To continue to show your grace on them. We ask that you do that, and at the end of the day, you would receive the crown of glory when the chief shepherd comes. We give acknowledgement to a few outside people other than the church congregation, Jacob Harman from Holland, Michigan, who played a pivotal part in keeping the flock together. We want to thank John McArthur and his ministry, Grace Advance, all the people there as mentioned. We want to single out the men that has been personally touching our lives since March this year, or actually since many months ago, middle of last year, but we've met them in person. Lord Todd Murray, who shines the love of Christ in manner of speech, example, and we can come to love. Please thank Jerry Rack for the enormous example of leadership he set. And yet, Lord, he's a man that understands the weight of leadership and does so in humility. We want to thank Jim and Bob and all the professors at Grace Emmanuel Bible College for what they do to move the gospel forward. I want to pray for this congregation then, that we submit ourselves to this man, and that we clothe ourselves in humility towards each other, and that we shall be eager to maintain a peace of unity amongst each other. We ask you to pray this way.
Heavenly Father, Lord God Almighty, we give thanks for this day. All honor and praise and glory is yours, Father. We are worthy of nothing, but we give you your grace. That was enough. Lord God, we hope that you will bless David with a long and righteous life in Squamish. We pray that David will never know pride, but pity, and that he will preach Christ's first time in the meeting behind that very solemn word. Lord Jesus, we give thanks again for this day. We give thanks for my brothers and my sisters and the congregation. And we are on a very narrow path, but that path we will walk. I honor you, Lord Jesus, my Lord.
I just wanted to share a piece of scripture in Philemon, chapter 1, verse 4 through 7, as Paul the Apostle was sharing his love with Philemon, about Philemon and to Philemon. Although I had a difficult time sharing my emotions, I thought I would just read this. I thank my God always, making mention of you in my prayers, because I hear of your love and of the faith which you have towards the Lord Jesus and towards all the saints. And I pray that the fellowship of your faith may become effective through the knowledge of every good thing which is in you for Christ's sake. For I have come to have much joy and comfort in you, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, brother.
Thank you for your support. thank you for your love for us already. It's been 3 months, and we had the opportunity a couple weeks ago to go home to Ontario, where we grew up, and it was a good opportunity for us to say that this is now home. Squamish is our beloved, Church 99, our beloved people, and keep my feet to the fire of the very things that Todd charged me with. That is the work of Expository Seminary, that is the work of Grace Middle Bible Church, to train young men to be faithful to the Word of God. And so that's what I desire to do and intend to do. And we'll do this together, right? We're going to do this as a church family. I'm a shepherd and you might be the sheep, but we're going to do this together. And so our final song is the church's one foundation, Jesus Christ. And so I couldn't imagine a better song to end as a congregation. Supporting me, I lead you, and we do this together for the sake of Christ and His church. So music team, would you please come up and lead us in this last final song.
You may stand.
Everything up for the sake of the gospel. And so I pray that we are those today who are willing to be called slaves of Christ, to glorify our Master, to diligently seek Him. And so we thank You for the Church of 99. We thank You for the provision that You have made through their hands for lunch today. May You bless our speech. May it be wise and saturated with gospel truth. And bless those who have prepared and labored hard to serve and bless us today. Pray that You would send Todd and Tammy and their dear children off being charged in ministry. Grant them safe travels as they go home. And as we as Church 99 send our greetings and our blessings back to GIBC and the Expositor Seminary. Thank You for such a wonderful day that You provided by Your hands. May it cause us to worship and magnify Christ today. In His name we ask. Amen.
Amen.
You are dismissed. Thank you so much for being here today.